schools for jobs to make me more tactical and more proficient in my job as a leader. And I started going through leadership schools, and then after that, it was 2003 of March 19th, and that was when we invaded Iraq. And we again went over to Kuwait, sat in Kuwait for a little while, and then we went straight up the gut for Iraq. My vehicle was the second vehicle to actually cross the Euphrates River in Iraq, and my vehicle was also the second vehicle to go into the heart of Baghdad. So you can imagine how many things that I've actually seen through that experience, just going straight up the gut. And then from there, we came back, did another 6 month workup, and then took back off and went right back to Iraq. Well, this time we went back, and this one was a lot different than the first one. Because if you imagine the first one, we took all Camp Pendleton, all the Marines, and then sent them over there. And we were done in, I think it was like 35 days, the whole entire war was done and over with. And that's how long it took us to actually take over Iraq, which was, pretty phenomenal. And then after that, for the second time I went over there, I don't know if you guys know the battle in Najaf in the cemeteries. I was actually in that fight. And I can tell you through my experiences, somebody's watching over me, if that makes sense to you. And then, I've got my goggles shot off, RPGs, which are rocket-propelled grenades, actually hit the wall and stand right beside me, a foot beside me, and not go off. So I'm like, I'm lucky to be just standing here today. And 17 individuals that I was actually in charge of during that battle, there was only myself and two other individuals that actually walked away unscathed. And I looked at my pants and everything like that, and there were nothing but metal shrapnel everywhere, and I was just like, wow, somebody was really watching there. So I went and I did that one, and I came back, and I decided, I want to flourish, I want to stay in the Marine Corps, I want to make this a career, I want to do 20, I want to get my pensions, I want to make this a career, and this is something that I love to do. Because I was thinking about it before I signed up, and I was always like, man, I got to go to work. I got to go to work again. You wake up and you do the same routine over and over and over. And I finally found something that I really love to do. And my thing is if you really love to do it, then why not stick with it? And I'm very passionate about it because I believe in fighting for something that you believe in. You want to talk about a Republican, I'm as Republican as you can get. So what I have for you right here is about a 15-minute, I'm going to tell you about, what all these mean and everything like that, and a little bit more open it for questions for you guys. But I have about a 15-minute video for you guys that was actually my unit over in Iraq. And what we did is after we were done, we came back. You have numerous time on your hands, so all the computer whizzes got together and they made a video for our brothers that have actually fallen, and this is the video. So
if this is loud enough, I can go across the way. Who's there?
Frozen?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Those concrete pillars right there are about 30 feet tall and about 5 foot thick.
Oh, wow.
After being out there for about 45 days, you get to enjoy 2 alcoholic beverages, and that's it. The hottest they got over there was about 155.
Oh, God.
Whenever anybody leaves, we hand them a paddle because we're the Alpha Company Raiders, and we go for World War II is the island hopping campaign. That was my unit was actually them. So we took traditions and we passed them on.
Did everybody wear the helmet cameras?
Helmet camera? No, actually, some people tape little video cameras to their helmet as they were running through and doing things.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Well, those concrete walls, those were important. You guys brought those.
Yeah, yes.
But that big brown facade that was about 2 minutes ago, that was already there, established by what you guys went and said, this looks like a good place to hang out.
Pretty much.
We, that was the military, with the internal parts there, was that already set for military operations?
No, what we actually did was we contracted out all the Iraqis, and then they did the work for us to throw back money into the country to help them rebuild and everything like that. And then we rebuilded some of them too as well. This is at Camp Pendleton right here on our way back.
Lance, I only saw one person with a facial camouflage.
That was my,
Was that unusual or what was that?
Yeah, it's extremely unusual.
Okay.
That was actually my number one individual that worked for me. And that guy just wanted to paint his face, so I let him, it was like, what are they going to do, spank us?
Now, your commander there seemed to be saying something in rhyme. What was that?
Yeah, it's, that was the Band of Brothers speech. That was the Band of Brothers speech.
And he got you to all say it?
And we all said it. And what we all said together was, whoever sheds his blood, we few, we happy few, whoever sheds his blood with me shall forever be my brother, is what we said. And then he went on, and those too afraid to go will think themselves lesser men, how they have learned how we have fought and died together. And then at the end, it was Alpha Raiders, because that's what we were. He said Alpha, and then we said Raiders. It was our way of showing each other that we're brothers and we're there for one another. So, yeah. Can I answer your question?
Yes.
I have a question.
Absolutely.
When you have all the equipment over there and with all the sand, how do you work with that? There must be a lot of problems with the sand getting into the vehicles and everything, and so they might malfunction?
Yeah, there was a lot of things that did malfunction, but the way we think about things is you gotta adapt, you gotta overcome, you gotta improvise. And I've seen an oil filter for a Humvee come out of duct tape and cardboard. So, I mean, you've seen some weird things, and the stuff actually does work. And the biggest thing is PMing, personal maintenance of all the vehicles, and all the, like, your gear just in general. I can't count how many times I cleaned my weapon over there. Because the way I thought about it was this was my weapon, and I have to keep this clean, because if this doesn't function, this doesn't operate, then I might not see home. So, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
So we cleaned it a lot.
I worked about 15 years ago, I worked with a retired Marine, Greg Kern, and he didn't like it in 22 caliber rifle. He liked like the M14, the 2.22 cartridge.
Oh, it's a 5.56.
Yeah, 5.56. He liked the 7.6 too.
Yeah, I can see why. It's bigger.
Well, he said one shot, one shot.
Yeah, that's snipers. Sniper use that. You can actually take a 7.62 and put it in. It's almost to the equivalent of a 30-06. Yeah. So I mean,
Yeah, no, we as the infantry line had 5.56, because it was a NATO ball round.
Right, but did it do the job?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. It was remarkable, remarkable. The distance, they actually, they took the M16A2 and they resurfaced it and everything like that. Colt came out with M16A4. And it's got a heavier barrel, so the velocity of the round travels actually farther. And it's more accurate. And the things that they're coming out with now is just amazing. Amazing. 5.56. 5.56. I personally had six magazines on my drop pouch right here. I had about, I want to say, 12 magazines right here on my left chest. It was just the left side of my chest right here. And then I had another like 4 or 5 magazines in my backpack.
30 rounds?
Yeah, 30 rounds. I put them with 25 because the more you actually put in, the more it boxes up the spring in the left, and the more likely you are to actually jam your weapon because it's trying to push them up. Right. With it being so compact in there, so I put about 25. But that wasn't my true weapon. My true weapon, the way I thought about it, was my true weapon was those 17 young individuals that wanted to go out and get some. So because I was in charge of them, you know, I told them what to do, and then they went and did it. So that's what I thought was my real weapon. So, as far as these are concerned, does that answer your question, Trevor?
Yeah.
Okay. As far as like these are concerned, the way I like to tell this is just like, this is your story. This is your story of what you've done and what you've accomplished inside the military. And every star that's on here means that you've gotten one more of those awards, because what's the sense of putting two ribbons on a star? So this right here means that I've been overseas 3 times. The stars are twice, and then the actual ribbon itself is one. Right here is the Global War on Terrorism. That'd be self-explanatory. This one's a Global War on Terrorism Expeditionary. What this one means is that you're SOC, which is Special Operations Capable. And that means you can go from ship to shore with combat operations. This one right here is the Iraqi campaign, which means that I've been to Iraq. This one right here is the Afghanistan campaign, which means that I've been to Afghan. And then this one is the Armed Forces. All it pretty much is I sat in Kuwait for 30 days of peace, so I sat in Kuwait for 60 days. That's how I got that. This one is National Defense. This one right here is the Marine Corps Expeditionary Medal, and this is probably the hardest medal to actually achieve, because what the Marine Corps is actually designed to do is to go from ship to shore with combat operations, and that means that I've gone ship to shore with combat operations, and that's the hardest medal to actually achieve. This one means I haven't gotten any trouble. I haven't gotten any trouble for 3 years apiece. And this one means the Navy, this is a Navy unit accommodation, which means the Navy said that our unit did something well. This one right here says the President of the United States said that our unit did something well. This one is a combat action ribbon, which means that I've gotten shot at. And this one's the Navy and Marine Corps Achievement Medal. Now, the easiest way to actually explain this is to not explain it, just let you guys read it. So I have the citation right here, and then right below it is the star and what I got those for. Now, I'll let that pass around just so you guys can read those. And pretty much what it is it's a Navy and Marine Corps Achievement Medal with Combat Distinguishing Device with Valor. And it just means that you've gone above and beyond what your job was actually designed to do, if that makes sense to you. To tell you the story behind the certificate for it is I was in an amphibious assault vehicle, which is an armored tank pretty much with a personnel carrier inside of it, and I was on the top for air security, and I'm looking down and I see this Humvee, you know, that had a 50 caliber on top of it, and they were shooting it at a building. And that building was shooting back. And I looked at him and I said, hey, we gotta go, we gotta help these individuals over here, because, you know, all they are is in a vehicle and they're just sitting out there in the middle of nowhere.
And they were like, yeah, we're going. Well, they weren't moving to my liking, if that makes sense to you. So I jumped out of the vehicle, I slid down the side, and then all my boys said, hey, you know, Sergeant White's going. So then from there, they dropped the back into the gate. Well, my platoon sergeant, the individual that was actually in charge of me, had to take off his helmet for the comm for the vehicle. And he was, if you can just imagine, like, being in, like, a little cubby hole, maybe probably about, like, this big, right, sitting down. And he had to take off his helmet, put his other helmet on, and then he had to crawl out of the space, crawl up the vehicle, and then crawl down. By the time he got back around, I already had four guys in custody. I already had one of my teams was marking targets for air to come through. And they were already searched, so the whole entire fight was over with by the time my boss actually got around to seeing me. And that's what I got that one for. And the STAR is, I'm a Marine Corps combat instructor of water survival. It's the second hardest course that the Marine Corps has to provide for you. And pretty much in general, I mean, I can tell you a lot about it. I can tell you a lot of definitions, like the definition of panic is a sudden unreasoning and overwhelming terror that destroys a person's capacity for self-help. But the way that's actually, they designed it for was, they put us through 4 months of vigorous training in order for us to understand what it actually feels like when you're that victim actually getting ready to drown. And so I would better help them. And I can't count how many people I've actually saved in the pool. And I was an instructor for 8 months. And what I did was, I'm also a basic Chief Scout swimmer. And it's kind of like the Navy SEALs, if you want to say it like that. We recon the surf zone, and then we'll recon the beach landing site, and then I'll set up an ITG, a marker, and a guide for all the Zodiacs, the combat rubber reconnaissance craft, to actually come in. And because there's certain ways that you have to do it in order for them to actually be on at the beach without flipping the Zodiacs. And so I was the one that swam in ahead of everybody else. And I was in charge of 17 individuals with all their gear, which is millions of dollars worth of like wetsuits, gear, communication, and everything like that. And I made sure that everything was accounted for. And with that being said, I did a pretty good job because they gave us new stuff. And not one of my individuals that I trained to go down to Coronado to actually go through this course failed. Every single one of them passed, so they were pretty excited about that one. I can tell you what the Marine Corps has done for me personally, and what I've realized is, I mean, with everything that I've been through, with war and everything like that, you can kind of think, you know, you're put in a position to where you had to grow up where something would actually happen. And I grew up really fast. I really did. I mean, I started realizing, you know, how important these chairs are to you when one day they're not there. I remember sleeping in the mud going, man, this is not good. And then, you know, to the next night having a bed. And I was just, you know, it's remarkable to actually realize how many things I took for granted when I was back here. And you don't really think about it until everything's gone or it's ripped away from you and you don't have it anymore. And what I realized through that is it's given me my building blocks for my future. I.e., I mean, somebody can hand me a plane ticket, you know, and they can take that plane ticket back as fast as they handed it to me. Somebody can hand me some money, and as fast as they handed me the money, they can take it away from me. They can hand me for an opportunity for an education, but if it's no good, I don't actually go get it. And what I've realized is that the Marine Corps has given me the building blocks for my future. The discipline to actually sit through and get a college degree. Through all the colleges that I've actually gone through, I've gone through a little bit of colleges and the degrees are back there, but they're just little things that I've done. And the lowest grade that I've gotten is a 92. You know, and you're looking at an individual that his father was all excited if he got a D. It's giving me the self-confidence to walk up into a room and act like I own that room and go make my money. That's the biggest thing that the Marine Corps has done for me. And the reason why I am so passionate about it is because of all those individuals that I've served side by side. Because I've realized what it takes to actually have that flag fly. I mean, to me, when I was in high school, I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I was looking at that flag like, wow,
That's our flag. That's what we do. And now I realize what it actually means to actually have that flag waving. And that, to me, I can actually stand here and say, yeah, you know, I'm proud of that flag. So, do you guys have any questions for me in any which way, shape, or form?
Just one other question. Did your family or relatives try to discourage you at all or from going back again repeatedly?
Absolutely. At first, my mother and my father, when I first joined, they said, that's not too bright. You don't want to do that. And I was driven, I was hard-headed, and all I wanted to do was, I'm going to go. And the whole time they were like, no, you shouldn't do that, discouraging me the whole entire way. But then by the time I went through boot camp, graduated from boot camp, came out of boot camp, it was the greatest day of my life, truthfully. Because my mom came over to me and she gave me a hug and her eyes were watering and she said how proud she was of me. And my old man looked at me, he stuck out his hand and he gave me a handshake and he said, son, I'm proud of you. And to me, I started realizing later on through life what they were actually meaning when they were trying to discourage me. And the way I was thinking about it was, they're my family. They're going to worry about me. Because if they didn't worry about me, then I would really wonder what kind of family I had. You know, I mean, it's the truth, because they're going to worry. And that's what they did the whole entire time. And when I said, I'm going back again, they were like, how come you're going back? What are you going back for? What are you fighting for? What are you doing? You know, all these questions arose to them. And the biggest thing that I came up with talking to them is because, I mean, I can sit here and I can tell you stories and stories and stories and stories of remarkable things to me that have happened. But to you guys, it's going to be a story. And to me, it's like I'm going to be living it as I'm telling you. Does that make sense? And the biggest thing I can say is, as far as political views are concerned, I don't care this, that, or the other thing. Oil, whatnot, this, that, and the other thing, I don't care. What I care about is I care about the guy to my left, to my right, in front, and back. And those are the reasons why I go back. And if I had the opportunity and they were to say, hey, you know, do you want to go back to Iraq tomorrow? I'd be done in an hour, packed and ready to go, saying, I don't know why I'm not on a plane yet. Because of those young individuals. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.